USA Radio News with Jason Wirt.
The Honorable Paul D. Ryan of the state of Wisconsin, having received a majority of the votes cast, is duly elected Speaker of the House of Representatives.
Paul Ryan getting another term as Speaker of the House of Representatives. The U.S. House Speaker is the only position in the House voted on by the entire House. Ford announcing today they're expanding a plant in the United States and canceling one in Mexico because of Donald Trump.
All of these factors have prompted us, obviously, to invest in Flat Rock's expansion and to cancel building a new plant in Mexico.
Some House Republicans dropping efforts to weaken the Independent Office of Congressional Ethics. After a firestorm of controversy, House Republicans held an emergency meeting to remove the plan from a package of rules that will be voted on. Leaders on both sides of the aisle had opposed the ethics rule change. Get more news online at usaradio.com. A horrific tragedy involving poison gas in Texas. Correspondent Chris Barnes has more.
Four children ranging in age from 7 to 17 died from that gas that was emitted when water was applied to a pesticide that had been placed under the residence. Reports are no criminal charges are pending. It appears to be just an unfortunate accident. Several people still hospitalized, including some first responders. I'm Chris Barnes.
Police in Aurora, Colorado, trying to determine if a body discovered in a pond is that of a missing 6-year-old boy. A police spokesman says David Puckett was seen earlier on Saturday with someone who is not a family member. Investigators think the child wandered away from home, but they are talking to known sex offenders in the area. President-elect Donald Trump tapping attorney Robert Lighthizer to be the next U.S. trade representative. The move to name the former Reagan administration official to the post as the nation's chief negotiator and advisor was confirmed today by the office of the president-elect. Get more news and analysis online at usaradio.com. The owner of the San Diego Chargers won't give a direct answer to the question about whether they're going to move to Los Angeles. Here's more in the story from Jason Campadonia.
President of Football Operations for the Chargers, John Spanos, is sidestepping any questions regarding a possible move.
Well, what we know right now, it's one of two locations, and it's an announcement that I don't know when it's going to come, but I hope it's coming soon.
The team has until January 15th to make a decision about moving to L.A. County and then sharing a new stadium with the L.A. Rams in the next few years. Right now, the team has no head coach, and a wide-ranging search is underway.
So we've begun the process of putting together a list. Throughout the process, at least initially, we're going to keep the list kind of between us.
Sports analysts say if the team does make the move to L.A., they'll have a better chance at getting a more desirable head coach. Jason Campadonia, San Diego.
Mark Hamill, Luke Skywalker of Star Wars fame, is remembering his late co-worker Carrie Fisher. Here's more on the story from Mark Mayfield.
Actor Mark Hamill is remembering his late Star Wars co-star Carrie Fisher. In a guest column for The Hollywood Reporter, Hamill wrote that making Fisher laugh was a badge of honor. He reflected on meeting a 19-year-old Fisher before the two started filming together and said he was captivated by how brutally candid she was. Hamill added, quote, "She was a handful, but my life would have been so much drabber if she hadn't have been my friend." Fisher died last week after suffering a heart attack on a flight to Los Angeles. Mark Mayfield.
For more news and analysis, check out westernjournalism.com. This is USA Radio News.
I'm attorney Phil Giacino, and this is Standing on Principle here on WLINY.com, Long Island, New York, the world. My co-host is author and educator Frank Vetro. Good evening, Frank.
Good evening, Phil. Sorry, I'm fumbling around a little bit.
Okay. You're still learning the ropes.
Still learning a little bit.
Engineer's booth.
Well, we got it. We got it all covered. You're on the air. It's all accounts.
Okay, very good. Frank, what I wanted to start talking about tonight was this. If you read the paper, if you listen to the news, the numbers are in for Chicago. Chicago is under siege. I did a little board here, Frank.
Oh, we got visuals.
We got visuals tonight. Can you see it?
I can see it, yes.
Okay. In Chicago, and these are pretty scary numbers.
All right.
Last year, 2015, there were 468 murders, mostly shootings, but 468. This year, Frank, do you know what that number jumped to?
Oh, I'm reading it.
700, and that's right.
I got it.
762. There were 713 people shot and killed. The difference is probably either beatings or stabbing.
Okay.
Then you have shot and wounded, 3,665. And the total is 4,368. So in a city with about 2.7 million people, those are two murders a day, Frank. It's pretty scary.
That's a lot.
Two a day. Right? And if you look at the total number of shot, that's 12 a day. So think about a little city, and you're a cop. Every single day, 12 people on average are being shot. And I'd like to know what they're doing about it. We've had this discussion many, many times. Now, you talk about New York. You talk about Los Angeles. Chicago has had twice as many shootings and murders than New York and L.A. combined, which is pretty scary because Los Angeles has a lot of places where there are a lot of shootings. They still don't equal the numbers if you add New York to the mix of what Chicago is facing.
Right.
Now, I don't know if you knew this. I'll call this the backstory. In 1982, Chicago passed a law. 82 was the year I graduated high school. They passed a law that outlawed guns, Frank. Outlawed them.
In 1982?
1982.
All right.
10 years later, 1992, the shootings, or the murders actually, jumped by 41%. While the rest of the country experienced an 11% increase in murders. So you're taking the guns out of the law-abiding citizens. You're leaving them like sitting ducks. The bad guys get the guns, and 41% increase in the murders. Now, there was a law, McDonald v. Chicago in 2010. That got rid of the ban, but they still have strict gun laws. You can't just open up a gun shop in Chicago. It's regulated where you can open it, what part of town, what you can sell. So with strict gun laws, you have these numbers. And these numbers are scary. This is not something where you can take it lightly.
Well, because what's happening with the, maybe I'm wrong, you tell me, with these shootings, they're gangs, they're illegal guns.
Right. If you looked at the guns that were used in these shootings, 60% came from out of town. They were stolen, brought in some other way. But the bottom line is these shootings are not being done by law-abiding citizens.
Right.
That's not happening. And also, these are not assault rifles, Frank, that are killing people. You know how they say, you got to stop the assault rifles? If you got rid of all the assault rifles, these numbers would look the same. And these are handguns. These are handguns that are being brought in illegally. This is not some card-carrying NRA member that's going out and shooting somebody. So if tomorrow you relax the gun laws in Chicago, you're still going to have these numbers. But the good guys now could arm themselves
right. And
protect themselves. That's why you go to Chicago, you go to Texas, you go to Oklahoma, where guns are allowed, you don't see these numbers, Frank. You don't see a fraction of these numbers.
What is the 12 a day? That's the total shot, 12 a
total
day?
Total shot.
12 a day.
Everything, shot, killed, wounded, 12 a day.
All right, 12 incidents a day.
12 shootings a day.
Wow.
Right? And shootings, it's like 1.95.
Right.
Just the shooting deaths. If you add total murders, it's 2 a day. But that's still pretty high.
Hell yeah, it's high.
Now, you have to ask yourself, what are they doing about it? Not much, because this number almost doubled from last year. Last year was 468, and now it is 7, not quite double, but much higher.
Right.
It's a much higher number. So they're going in the wrong direction.
Right.
Now you have Rahm Emanuel, who's the mayor of Chicago, and he's talking about he wants to make sure it remains a sanctuary city. He wants to make sure that illegal aliens that come in are not going to be rounded up. Now, I would suspect most of these shootings are not illegal aliens. All right, some might be, but this is just the way that city is set up, where it's lawless.
Wasn't this guy?
This is worse than the old West.
I'm no expert on politics, and I'm probably wrong. Wasn't Emanuel like part of Obama's cabinet at some
yes,
point?
Yes, he was.
He was, right?
He's from Chicago.
And he's from Chicago.
He was one of his guys.
Yeah, exactly.
A number of years ago. I think
of
it was
course.
In the first term,
right.
If I'm not mistaken. Then he left. He became mayor. So instead of worrying about sanctuary cities, which are against the law, against federal law, he should do something. Now, if I was the mayor, I don't profess to have all the answers, but if my citizens are being slaughtered, I might say, you know what? Let's send in the National Guard and set up patrols, because two a day. And they're not all gangs. There are innocent people that are getting shot. I heard one story where a girl was sitting in the house and a stray bullet killed her. So if you're a law-abiding citizen, in Chicago, I'd want there to be tougher, not gun laws, I want there to be tougher laws or put more police on the street, do something to protect myself and my children if I lived in that environment. And I looked up, there are websites, you can look up and find out exactly where these people are shot. A lot of it's the same neighborhoods.
Right.
You know, this isn't the nice neighborhood. These are happening where there's poverty, where there's drugs. Something's got to be done.
I just shot, because I'm an idiot, I just shot some type of mean face across the screen. If anybody saw something negative go across, that was me. I messed up. But, and a lot were done on Christmas Day, right? Christmas weekend.
That weekend, I think there were like 11. Now, for December alone, this is just December 2015, there were 53 murders, shootings in Chicago. 242 shot and wounded, a total of 58 people murdered. So here we are, that's about two a day.
Right.
In the 31 in December, but it's about two a day. So the year ended pretty much with the average. Now, you think about it, they say that murders are higher generally in the warmer weather, summer, more activity on the streets. December in Chicago is not warm and sunny, generally speaking.
No.
And it's the holidays. So around Christmas time, you had about two a day. Now, if these murders were happening in some of the fancier neighborhoods, you know they would do something about it.
Right.
But because these are happening in poor neighborhoods, I don't know what efforts they're doing.
But the poor neighborhoods, these are the people that are voting for them. Hey, guys, they're mm-hmm. trying to help you. What do you mean, Phil?
Well, look, New York had a lot of murders a while back, and then Giuliani came in, Republican.
That's right.
And they had stop questioning frisk, remember?
Right.
And that helped. And then a liberal administration, de Blasio, comes in, and he says, let's get rid of that. Now, if I'm a poor person in a bad neighborhood and I can't leave that neighborhood, I'm going to want some strong policing.
Right.
Because how do I protect my kids?
I think what Giuliani did, I think that's part of the problem right here at home in the Brentwood Bayshore area with all the outbreak with the gangs and the unsolved murders that have taken hold of the towns. This is my opinion. I have nothing to go on, really. I think I have a lot of students from those areas. I think because of they're afraid of being accused of, was it profiling or whatever?
Right. Racial profiling.
Yeah, whatever it may be. They're afraid to question certain groups of people. Even though we know the gangs, the MS-13s, El Salvador, and all
absolutely.
These people, but they won't. They're afraid to question.
You know what's interesting, and I know this for a fact because I am an attorney and I'm in the family courts often. Now, in Riverhead, they have a part, and they're going to have one in CI, where they deal with what they call unaccompanied minors. From Central America, not Mexico, not South America. There's a certain law on the books. If a child comes over from Central America unaccompanied by an adult, they are given a hearing. They're given an attorney, and they have a hearing. And generally, it's rubber stamped. And what they say is, well, if it's a girl and they were sent back to Guatemala or some other Central American country, they're going to be raped. If it's a guy, they're going to be killed because of a grudge or they'll be indoctrinated into a gang. So what happens? They come here, and we know for a fact that a lot of them are going to MS-13 and some of these gangs.
That's
because
right.
Let's just say you're a kid, you come here, you're 16 years old, and you're with a relative, or maybe someone's not even a relative. And then the gang comes up to you and says, hey, come on, we're blood. You come from El Salvador. Join the club. What are these kids likely to do? It's like maybe you and I would join a football team or the baseball team or the hockey team. That's what these kids are joining.
That's right. They have no family. They're escaping, you know. Obviously, it's not good where they are. That's why they're coming here. And they don't have money. I work with these kids. I know it. They have nothing. So the gang becomes their family.
Right.
That's what happens.
And again, there are laws that allow these children to stay. Now, if a child comes through here unaccompanied, obviously we have to deal with them. And I'm not saying we automatically send them back, but that's why we have to build the wall to make sure that nobody comes into this country unwelcomed. If someone's going to come here, they have to fill out the application. They have to follow the law.
Right.
And then we won't have this.
And then the response is, oh, it takes so long. Yes, that's right. It takes a while. Do it the right way. It took a long time for my family to get here, too, from Italy.
Right.
It took years.
Follow the law. Because if you're a law-abiding citizen, let's say from another country, and you want to come here, and you pay the money, and you hire the attorney, and you wait online, and all these people are cutting you, Look, if you're at Disney and somebody cuts you, you get pissed off. Imagine trying to come to America and somebody cuts the line.
That's right.
You're going to say, wait a minute, what am I doing here? What am I doing wrong? Not only that, but a lot of those people that come here illegally get a package of benefits.
Yeah, exactly.
That you and I are paying.
Right.
Now, I want to segue into something that I was very, very happy.
Not to mention, a couple things. Not to mention the package plus the amount of money, because they get so much as far as education. Not that they don't need it, but we're footing the bill for so much that they need educationally. It gets put on us. Let me read you some comments, Phil.
Okay.
Couple of hellos from everybody. Hi, Phil. Hi, Frank. How you doing, guys?
How you doing?
We have Marissa saying they're probably, with regard to the guns, Marissa says they're probably all illegal and defaced guns. What's a defaced gun?
Serial numbers taken off.
Oh, gotcha. I didn't know that.
Yep.
All right.
That's why I make the big bucks, Frank.
Are these shootings gang on gang or shooting civilians as well?
It's a lot of turf wars, gang on gang, grudges.
And Chris says an armed society is a polite society.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're right, Chris.
Well, you know the expression when they talk about the First Amendment, which is free speech, freedom of the press, religion, and all that, and they say the way to combat bad speech isn't less speech, it's more speech. In other words, if you hear something you don't like, get up there and speak.
Right.
Whether it be write an article, come on a radio show, talk to your friends. The way to protect innocent people is not less guns. And I know this sounds crazy to the liberals, and their heads are going to explode. It's more guns. Think about it, Frank. If you were in the Smith Haven Mall,
yeah,
and it's a gun-free zone, and a bad guy comes in with a gun, who's going to stop him in the first 10, 15, 20 minutes? No one.
Nobody.
If Frank Vetro, heaven help us.
He doesn't even give me a chance to answer, guys. Or, jeez.
I knew the answer. No.
Okay.
Or
no
Phil,
one. No one.
That's right. Or Phil Jacinto or some citizen of the United States that has a legal gun, he's going to be able to, you know the expression again, how do you stop a bad guy with a gun? A good guy with a gun.
That's right.
So if I'm in the mall and I'm not armed and a bad guy takes out a gun, unless I'm 2 feet away to jump him, I have to take cover.
Right.
Because I'm going to get shot, right? Or I have to make a run for it. If I'm armed, and now look, the police will get there at some point, but a lot of times the police are going to get there and surround the perimeter.
Right.
They might not go in immediately without knowing what's going on.
Right. It's not the movies. Not just going to kick down doors. It's not
right.
What you see.
This is not Dirty Harry where he walks in and he takes out four assailants.
Right.
So the bad guy there, do you know, remember the guy that was dressed as Santa Claus in Turkey who killed like 39 people?
Yeah.
He reloaded a number of times. In Florida, that guy reloaded. He reloaded.
At the nightclub.
A number of times.
Yeah.
That's the time when you take that guy down. But if nobody has a gun, everybody is trampling over everybody else to make it to the exits. Remember
right.
In Terminator, at the club, well, he was the Terminator, but see how everybody ran and they didn't even look back.
Right.
And that guy had a chance to shoot everybody up. If a guy had a gun, a legal gun, he could be able to return fire and knock that guy down.
Not only that, maybe just the fear. If we just like in Texas, the fear of, well, you know what? Somebody's going to have a gun here. This is not a gun-free zone. Like this, there will be a gun. You walk into a library or a church, you're a pretty good
soft
assumption
target.
That, hey, there's no guns in here.
Right. Look, gun-free zone.
That's right. So just the thought of, you know what? Somebody might have a gun here. Well, may deter. These guys are like bullies in a courtyard with the guns and they're in gun-free zones.
Right.
They know they're not going to get hit.
Well, look, imagine somebody going into an NRA convention and trying to shoot the place up. They might take out one guy, maybe two, but they're going down.
Right.
Because somebody's going to pull out a gun, a weapon. That's why gun-free zones are the most idiotic thing I'd ever heard of. Because would you put, let's say you have a store, a jewelry store, and you say, I want a gun-free zone, and you put up a gun-free zone sign. What are you telling the bad guy?
Come rob me.
He's not going to meet with any resistance.
Right.
Would that same guy put up a gun-free zone sign in front of his house? I don't think he would. Because you don't want the bad guy to know that I don't have a gun in my house.
I don't think anybody puts up a gun-free zone sign.
So why would you do it at a jewelry store?
Look, if I owned
a jewelry store, Frank, and there were people coming in that had legal handguns, I'd welcome them.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Because if the bad guy pulls out a gun, the good guy can return fire.
All right, we have a comment. Somebody who's a little loco, a little crazy, says Phil rocks. So there you go.
Who's
Phil,
that?
His name is Keith.
Keith, okay. Keith. I like to hear that.
All right,
I think
on.
I might know who it is.
Oh, you do?
Good guy.
Okay. If we carried a gun, we would stop somebody's we would stop somebody's crazy people before it got too far. If we carry a gun, we maybe can stop some of these crazy people before they got too far killing innocent people. There you go.
That's right. And that's the point I'm making. A good guy with a gun. All right. And now the lunacy, remember in Chattanooga, Tennessee, where that guy shot up, it was like a strip mall, and he might have killed one a recruiter. It was a military recruiter. They were not allowed to have guns. Now think of the lunacy. If you're not going to allow military personnel, right, to have a weapon in public, let's say, when they do their recruitment or whatever, why not?
Yeah,
why wouldn't
point?
You? Like, look, remember, I forget where it was, but there was a fellow that shot up a lot of people, killed a lot of people in one of the military bases. And he was brought down by somebody that was armed. Now, look, I'm not saying everybody should be armed, but we have a Second Amendment. If you have no felony convictions, if you're not mentally ill, whatever, you should be allowed to carry a gun. Now, people might think I'm crazy. What about Texas? There are places there you can get a carry permit very easily.
Nevada, they're carrying in Nevada.
Right. The shootings are not out of control. They hardly have any shootings there.
Right.
They, you know, I looked at some of the numbers. You don't. Well, I think it's Switzerland, where they almost make you have a gun. All right. They have more gun ranges than they do like recreational activities, like a bowling alley, an ice skating rink. Those kids learn at a young age to respect guns. We don't have. See, unfortunately, in our culture, in a lot of places, guns are not respected. Right. Guns are only seen as a means to an end. Let's say for an inner city thug who wants to kill somebody because he feels slighted.
Right.
Right. Now, I have guns. I've taken my kids shooting. I teach them to respect guns. Right. My son and I go shooting. We were shooting in Pennsylvania a couple of summers ago, and we respect the gun. Right. That's what you're supposed to be. When you have a little kid, it's nothing wrong to raise that kid to be able to handle a gun, to know how to use a gun. There may come a time in his life when he needs to do that.
Right.
Do you shoot, Frank?
I don't.
I got to take you sometime.
You should. I don't think they'll let me have a gun.
Why not?
Yeah, why not?
You don't have a criminal conviction.
I have nothing.
You're a troublemaker.
I need a reference. You don't have a criminal conviction. Will you vouch for me?
I will.
You would?
I don't know if it'll be enough, though.
I need somebody else?
No, no.
I need two people, right?
Well, what they do is they're going to work. Like, if you're not married, but if you were married, you'd have to have your spouse sign on to it, an employer, something like that.
I mean, I have been, my fingerprints have been cleared, like, to the, I work with the courts.
You might
for
be
crying out
get.
Loud, I work with the courts.
You might be
criminal
able to
and family courts.
See, I'd love to have, and I'm going to try again. Not that I was denied.
I want a shotgun. I want to put it on spread and just start cleaning up.
A shotgun's easy to buy.
I could get a shotgun?
Easier than a pistol.
Can I go in a garage and hack it off? And take...
No, that's against the law.
Oh, really?
And don't scratch out the serial number.
Deface it.
You can't. You're not allowed to do that.
I learned a new term, deface it. Ah, Christy says she will vouch for me. Thank you, Christy. Newfield student, way back.
Okay.
Way back in the day. Thank you.
Now, I want to segue. We were talking about...
I was going to go to play a commercial, but...
You want to play a commercial?
No, whatever you want to do.
Play a
it's
commercial.
Our show.
You got it.
All right, guys, you're listening to Standing on Principle. You're looking at Phil Jacino. Frank, that's the attorney extraordinaire. That's my attorney, actually. Well, we're going to play his commercial, but I'll vouch for him. He's a good attorney.
Thank you, Frank.
I am Frank Vetro. Some of you know me. If you don't, go to frankvetro.com. You listen to Standing on Principle every Tuesday, 8 o'clock. Anyway, you can't see me because I'm in a booth. We'll be back right after this. Yes.
What were you thinking?
I only had a few drinks.
And then drove home, really?
Look, I'm sorry.
Not as sorry as you're going to be.
Okay, so now what?
I guess we get you a lawyer.
Great. You know how I feel about lawyers.
Listen, Kelly's husband used Phil Jacino and Associates. She said he was fair, honest, and made sure that Jim had the legal representation he needed.
I don't know.
Listen, Kelly said Phil Jacino is an ex-Suffolk County Assistant District Attorney with over 24 years in practice.
Really? Practice? Couldn't get it right the first time?
You're joking. Facing fines, losing your license, and even jail, and you're joking.
You're right. What's Phil Jacino's number?
Smart man. Let me look at my phone. Okay, 631-588-3155.
Tell me again.
631-588-3155.
Where's his office?
2780 Middle Country Road, Suite 208 in Lake Grove.
Oh, right over by the Good Steer.
Yes, great place for your last meal if you don't get Phil on the phone.
Mistakes happen. When they do, you want an attorney you can
Frank.
Trust. Philip J. Giacino is that attorney.
Talk about Ford.
Give Phil a call at 631-588-3155. That's 631-588-3155. Or check out his website at www.giacinolaw.com.
What did Phil say?
Told me not to worry. Got an appointment with him for tomorrow afternoon.
Good. Now I'll get this little honey-do list for you.
A little community service. Maybe I should call my lawyer.
Still joking?
Give me the list.
An extraordinary story of a real-life David versus Goliath is told as Frank Vetro, a young charismatic principal on the rise of the educational system, has his life taken away like you won't believe. In Standing on Principle, Vetro provides a first-hand account in real time of an innocent man in the justice system and details the tedious struggle to clear his name. You will never hear another story like it. It broadens from local themes right here on Long Island to global themes of social political importance. Learn the struggles of Frank Vetro as a career was lost, as well as employment and his home. For more information about the book, go to frankvetro.com.
Here's a blast from the past, Phil. This ain't it.
That brings back memories, Frank. I'm attorney Phil Giacino, and you're back with Standing on Principle here on WLINY.com, Long Island, New York, the world. Frank just played a little music from our intro when we were on 103.9 FM, LI News Radio. Brought back some memories. I like that, Frank. Thank you. I love that song.
Yeah, it's a great song.
And we came to that together, remember?
Yeah.
Independently.
Independently.
Isn't that pretty amazing?
Yeah. Before you switch topics, one last comment. Christine says, my father was a police officer. We never saw his gun as children, but we always knew he had one on his ankle all the time.
That's why they behaved.
I was never afraid. Exactly.
Right.
There you go.
You got it. Hey, look, if you have guns in the house, I have a number of guns. I have a gun safe. You can't get into that thing unless you have the combo. It's a fireproof safe. It's one of these things where you have, like, the three bars go into the wall. You got to keep these guns safe. I don't have little kids now, but if you do, you got to keep these guns safe because little kids can get a hold of them, and obviously tragedy can happen if the kid takes the gun and shoots a neighbor or himself.
Hey, guys, if you want to call in, we see all your comments in the chat room. We can't monitor all the apps. We're just monitoring one. I can only do so many things, guys. But if you want to call in, 888-583-9930, extension 100.
One more time.
888-583-9930. Standing on Principle, Phil and I will take your calls. Oh, extension 100, by the way.
Extension 100.
Oh, let me make an announcement.
Yes.
Did you know this? Because I still don't know. What, just coming out of our pocket? What the hell's Eric doing to us? If you start every text once a day, so in the text box you put, you're going to text to 31996. Everybody listening, listen to me. Judging by your face, Phil, you don't know this.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
It was starting today, once a day, everybody, for like till the end of the month. If you text, so you're going to go to text messaging, text to, send to 31996. Then in the message box, the message will, you're going to type internet radio. Do that once a day, just do that once. But you can only do it up to one time a day. You at the end of the month, you'll be eligible to receive a $100 Visa gift card you're going to win.
Really?
How about that, Phil?
Well, you're not guaranteed the $100. You might win it.
You're
eligible for it.
So there you go. Okay.
Who's providing that?
That's what I just asked. But I guess we are. I guess WLINY is. Isn't that you, me, and Eric?
Yeah, I guess so.
I don't know.
We'll have to pass the hat around.
Yeah, so there you go.
What I wanted to do is change gears a little bit. In the news, it actually came out yesterday, today, Ford Motor Company was considering building a plant in Mexico for $1.6 billion, Frank. And they said that they changed their mind, and part of it was because of President-elect Trump, because they feel that he's really motivated to fight for America and to bring back business the way it should be. Ease up a little bit on the regulations, maybe lower taxes, do what needs to be done to make to allow companies to make more money. Instead, you know what they're going to do?
What are they
going to
do?
They're going to open up another manufacturing plant in Michigan, either Detroit or one of the suburbs of Michigan, which will create 700 manufacturing jobs. and jobs to create that. So on top of the 700 that will work there, 700 million, it's less than the 1.6 billion, and they're leaving jobs here or creating jobs here in this country. President, I'm going to call him President Trump. Okay. He's doing more for this country than Obama ever imagined.
And his stock went up, by the way.
Yeah, and I own quite a bit of Ford. So I was very happy about that.
Everybody, did you hear that? He doesn't just own a couple of shares. He owns quite a bit.
I own like nine. I'm kidding.
He owns quite a bit.
They're cheap. They're trading at about $12 and change.
In fact, he owns Ford.
But they pay about a 15-cent dividend. Okay. So it's pretty good yield.
Okay.
Good stock. Don't buy it yet. Let me buy some more stock, and then you guys can start buying in. That'll make me feel better. So Trump is fighting for us. And it's funny. I was watching Fox News a little while ago, and they were saying, I had a guy on who's, a businessman, and he said he's never seen anything like it where a president is actually going directly to these companies or having an influence on these companies. I never heard that before. The closest thing we ever had to a president that was a businessman was Bush. Remember? He owned a baseball team.
Yeah.
But he didn't run the government like a business. He was like the same old politician. Right. I liked the guy, but he was kind of like the same old politician. Trump is basically saying, hey, wait a minute, Boeing. You're spending too damn much for that plane. Come down on the price. We need somebody like that.
I think what, not that we know Trump so well, but being in the New York area.
I'm buddies with the guy. What are you talking about?
Being in the New York area, my whole life Trump has been in the news, right. You know, took over the company when I was born, his dad's company. So one thing the rest of the world, if they don't know, will learn. And I told this to a caller we had yesterday. This man works. He's never going to stop working. And the people he's bringing aboard to work with him, right. who have never worked with him before, let me tell the rest of the world that's listening to us right now. This guy works 24/7. He does not rest.
He's tweeting at like 3 in the morning.
Yeah, he gets things done. He's never resting. I think everybody's going to be, unless they're just lazy good for nothings, pleasantly surprised about what this man can get accomplished.
Right. And he's setting something in the infrastructure. You know, it's amazing. I'm 52, so I can't say, you know, for the last 50 years I've seen politics.
Right.
But from what I've seen, when you had presidents like Clinton, who didn't do a terrible job, but he wasn't a businessman. Bush, like I said, ran the government like, and he was more focused on the terrorism, remember? Because 9/11, right after he got in. So here's a guy that's coming in. He's already getting results, and he's not even the president yet. He gets one in about 2.5 weeks, right? Already, we're getting dividends. The stock market, remember Mark Cuban? Oh, the stock market's going to plummet. It hasn't, all right? It's doing well. You have companies like Ford, like Carrier. They're keeping jobs here.
Meanwhile, you're right. I agree 100%. I'm starting to think this might be extreme.
Okay.
Forget the part of how I'm not too thrilled about Democrats as a whole, what they believe in. And obviously, I have friends that are Democrats, but as a whole, the party. I think there's like almost communists in the Democratic Party. Communists. I'm like McCarthy, man. I want to witch hunt. I want to vet them out, man. I want to suck them out of their party because they're trying, as we speak, let's face it, they're trying to undermine Trump.
Absolutely.
Looking for ways to impeach him. They're meeting. They're doing this. They're going after eight cabinet members looking to investigate. They're trying to.
They got a target list.
Yeah. They're trying. Yeah, exactly. They're trying to delegitimize the results, even though 17, federal law. Now I'm going on a tangent here. 17 intelligence agencies and personnel have claimed that Putin, and I'm not saying that Russia didn't, that Russia hacked into the emails, and it's a situation. Somebody did, so...
Assange is saying what he did had nothing to do with Russia.
Right, but...
Where's the proof?
Exactly. But if you say that, it's un-American. Why is it un-American? Why have we learned nothing else that we shouldn't just be wholeheartedly trusting anybody?
Well, you know what's interesting? China, during the Obama administration, hacked into... intellectual property. And we really didn't do a damn thing. And then all of a sudden, what they did, it affected, let's say, the election. The Democrats lost. And now Obama is dispelling 35 diplomats from Nassau County, I think, up in Brookville.
That's right.
So where's the proportionality? When someone hurt us, our business interest, or some of our business interest, and we really do very little to them, and meanwhile, because Hillary got beat, he says it's the Russians. Where's the proof?
Right.
I don't want to hear supposition or theory. Where is the proof?
Not only that, if Obama knew, if it's true, if, and there's no proof yet.
If he had proof, it would have come out.
But he said himself that back in October, he met with, was it October or before that? He told Putin, knock it off.
No. He said, cut it out.
Cut it out. So
that's pretty sissy. Cut it out, guys.
So nobody makes a big stink. Yeah, but the point is, he knew something was up, but why did he wait till the
election? I'll tell you the reason. This is the absolute reason. He thought Hillary was going to win.
Exactly. Exactly. Now it's a big
Trump
deal.
Trump wasn't going to be president, so what's the big deal?
Now it's a big deal because he lost. But they, if it were true, they were on to something anyway and did nothing. Once again, these guys are just such lame ducks.
Look, if in October Trump was up 10 points in the polls, you know he would have done something about it.
Right.
But because it was a foregone conclusion that Hillary Clinton was going to be our next president, the 45th right. president, the first woman, a Democrat, to carry on Obama's policies.
Right.
It didn't work out that way. So all of a sudden, hey, wait a minute, we got to punish these guys because they affected the outcome.
Right.
Or so they say.
But, well, even if, well, first of all, even if Putin did hack it, let's say he did it.
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all,
he didn't affect the outcome. Right. Well, the facts of the emails may have affected
they were facts,
that.
Right.
Yeah.
But let's be clear, when they say he hacked the election, it didn't affect the voting, the numbers, the raw data. In other words, he didn't hack into a computer and add 10,000 more votes in Wisconsin for
right.
Donald Trump.
Right.
What happened was, in a sense, factual information came out. Not one time did any of those hacked say it's a lie.
Right.
What they said is, we don't want to dignify it.
Right.
Because, look, if someone, let's say, hacked you and it said Frank Vetro said something, and it wasn't true, what would you say? I never said that.
Right.
That is a lie. They didn't do that. You know why? Because they knew they couldn't.
Right.
They couldn't, because Assange would have come out with something,
right.
a video of them typing it in somehow. You know, he would have did something to show them for the liars that they were, so all they could do was say, it's not right.
Right.
Now,
how many of them came out to defend Donald Trump when his tax return, no. excerpts of his tax returns, certainly, surely, right. he didn't give it to them. Trump didn't get it. They were stolen.
Right.
But nobody
was
said anything.
Was it the
then.
Russians?
Yeah.
Now, Trump handled it a little bit better by basically, instead of saying, let's attack the source, let's talk about the substance. Yeah, I saved a lot of money on taxes. You know how I did that? I followed the law.
Right.
Just like I have an accountant. His job is to work within the law to save me money.
Right.
To pay less taxes.
And in the next 3 months, most of America is going to be looking for loopholes or telling their accountant or tax guy, mm-hmm. save me some money. Do your best. Go get them.
Right. And Donald Trump is trying to simplify. He, you know, in the past, it was all lip service. A president would come in, oh, I'm going to simplify the tax code. Never happened. I never even heard them trying to do it.
Right.
That's why the Democrats didn't have a message in the election. Again, if you went to a Democrat on the street, what is Hillary all about? Hamana, hamana. You'd hear like crickets chirping.
Right.
You wouldn't hear. You wouldn't get an answer. A five-year-old, if you went up to a five-year-old and you said, what is Donald Trump going to try to do? Build a wall. He likes the police. He wants to lower taxes. Maybe the five-year-old wouldn't say he wants to ease up on regulation.
Right.
But there are things that you can point to. What do you point to with Hillary? A basket of deplorables?
Right.
That's why I don't think Hillary, and I'm going to say it, I don't think Hillary is that smart of a woman. If she, you know how many unforced errors she made?
She lost two elections.
How many unforced errors, Frank?
All right. She lost two elections she was supposed to win.
Right.
Two. All right.
Obama was a community organizer, a one-term senator, came out of nowhere and kicked her butt. She hardly beat Sanders.
Right. Exactly.
In a rigged.
Exactly.
You know what I didn't like? Did you hear Schumer the other day say something about Trump's cabinet is rigged? Where the hell does he come off? So I don't know what he's talking about.
He's an idiot. Schumer's an idiot. Schumer's a moron. All right. Real original of him to say something about how many characters is it on Twitter? I don't know. 41? 140 characters doesn't make a president or something like that. Right. That's pretty creative.
But don't you always hear, we want presidents that are transparent, right?
Yeah.
We want to see sometimes how the sausage is made. You know the expression?
Yeah.
With Donald Trump, you feel like he's one of us. You always feel like you could pick up the phone and call him.
Well, exactly. Well, the media is beside themselves.
He's bypassing the media.
Because he doesn't need them.
He
doesn't need them. It's the social media age, and he's all over. It's direct. Nobody's editing it. It's not. It's unfiltered. There's no miscommunication. This is what. This is it.
Well, even when he was running, the funny, and we talk about this often, the funniest thing was he'd be at a rally, and the cameras would be on him, and he'd say, guys, back up the camera to show how many people are here.
Right.
Because we'd find out, because inevitably somebody who wants to show how many people would take a picture, it'd go on Facebook and all that. So he would say, look how corrupt they are. Look how crooked. And why did they keep him on? Because he's good for ratings.
Right.
Why was The Apprentice number one? Because it was good for ratings. Why does his book sell? People are interested in him.
Right.
Do you think that Fox News or even CNN would break to Hillary Clinton for an hour? Hell no.
Forget it.
That would preempt. You know what was great? A lot of times it would preempt, at the time, 7 o'clock, it would preempt Megyn Kelly. So she would come on, the camera would be on Donald Trump for almost a whole hour because the guy was entertaining.
Right.
And look, as long as he's not tweeting the nuclear codes, I think it's a good idea to let us know how he thinks.
Why not?
And sometimes he's smart enough to maybe say something that's opposite of what he's going to do.
Hey, yeah, exactly. Now, he says the media is like babies. They're like little bitches. He went to play golf. He didn't tell them. Well, he's not letting us take long.
He didn't bring the press corps.
Traditionally, you know, the White House, because we need to know his whereabouts. You don't need to know. I don't need to know that he was playing golf the other day. I don't care. So he's playing golf the other day. I don't need to know that he went to dinner. And the media's mad that he didn't tell them. The media is just a bunch of babies. And they need him. Mm-hmm. And this is what's pissing them off. But he doesn't need them. And right. He's showing them.
Look,
and good for them.
They were his enemy during the election. The only thing, I got to say this, the thing they did give him was coverage, all right? Putting the camera on him. But their written coverage was, he can't win. He's a buffoon. Every little thing that came out, that's it. He's done. Remember the Bush thing came out? Billy Bush?
Yeah.
Or he called, she said something about Fiorina's face, and then the Pope, and everything that came out,
took them all
he's
off.
Done. He's finished. He'll never be president. And I love, there was something on Facebook where it showed things that were said, like even Bush, Jeb, come on, he's never going to be president. What are you kidding me? Or when Ann Coulter, who I respect immensely, when she said, she was asked.
Right off the bat.
Who, out of the people running, who do you think is going to get the nod? And she said, just like you and I would say, Donald Trump. And they looked at her like, what are you, a friggin' idiot?
Yeah.
She got the last laugh. We all got the last laugh.
Yep. Absolutely. Now, how about the future?
Us deplorables got the last laugh.
That's right. How about the future of the Clintons now?
I don't want to hear Hillary Clinton's name anymore.
Their foundation. See, now,
who's going to donate?
Well, that's why Bill Clinton has vowed, because he's asking everybody for donations, because it's not pay for play anymore. She's not in government, right? Because they can't offer favors in return, he's offering to triple, Bill Clinton, whatever you donate, I will triple up to like 200 grand.
Matching.
Oh, they got some freaking, they got all this money. They were broke a few years ago. Remember the commercial?
I know. But you know what it is? It's no longer a quid pro quo.
Right.
Right. Now, I thought, I was at the mall around Christmas. I thought I saw Clinton in a Santa outfit with the kettlebell. And he was collecting donations. I could be wrong, but that's what I thought I saw.
No pay for play. So now they have to. I'll match it. I'll triple it. Whatever. Just, we need money. Donate to us. We can't give you favors in return.
I bet you they're not going to get a lot of. Now I heard somebody say that the Clintons are pretty much done, but that their daughter Chelsea might run for a congressional seat or something like that.
I hope not.
Look, she has every right to do what she wants to do. If she's anything like her mother, we don't want her in office.
Right.
Although, I'll be honest with you, she runs in some kind of Democratic enclave, she will win. The Democrats love her.
That'd be nice. It'd be like a tag team. She could run against Ivanka.
Ivanka would win.
She would. She's smarter.
It depends where.
It'd be a good matchup.
Remember,
right?
Charlie Rangel?
Yeah.
Where he ran, the people were interviewed and they said, look, he didn't kill anybody. Remember, he was crooked and the tax issue. And that guy, Pelosi, it's another one. People say, why does she keep getting elected? Because San Francisco. They want her because she can bring home the bacon because she's very powerful.
Right.
She's a minority leader.
Right.
And God forbid that the Republicans ever lose the majority. she could be the Speaker of the House again.
Right.
Because there's really nobody up against her. What I want to go back to that thing we were talking about, Ford Motor Company, for a second. And we talked about Trump is saving jobs. All right. I was listening to Geraldo Rivera, and he said, what about those Mexican workers that could have been employed had that plant been built in Mexico? Now, I have nothing against Mexican workers, Frank, but let's be honest. Who is the president hired to serve? He's hired to serve Americans.
That's right.
Not Mexican. Now, I would love to see a vibrant Mexican economy. It would help us, because if that economy was vibrant there, there are less people going to hop a fence, swim across the Rio Grande to come here because they have opportunities there. But the bottom line is the president's job is to do what he can to make America more prosperous. And that's what he has to do. So, Geraldo, you know, you want a job in Mexico? Why don't you open up a business in Mexico?
You know, Geraldo, man, he really rubs me the wrong way, to be honest with you.
Although tonight he was saying some positive, he was saying some positive things. I don't know where that guy is. You know what I mean? Like, if you listen to Bowling or you listen to Hannity, right, or you listen to Tucker, you kind of know where they are. They're consistent. Geraldo, one minute he could sound like a conservative, the next minute he sounds like a socialist.
Yeah.
I don't know where that guy is.
Yeah, he's neither here nor
there. He's all over the place.
Hey, listen, Marissa, I have not been ignoring you. She's been commenting like mad. But her latest comment, by the way, Sean joined. Don't worry about being late, Sean. And no, I did not screw up the phones yet because nobody called.
It doesn't ring in the booth. You got to look at the phone.
I know, that too.
It's like the bat phone.
That too. I also not. He really should put that screen over here. That's the one. And Marissa, your last comment, the media is a circus. I agree. I think the media is the biggest cause of, well, one of the biggest cause of the racial divide because of their rhetoric and their jargon and their propaganda. They cause this racial divide. And it just, it's. I don't think it's so much, I've been saying this forever, it's not so much racial, it's socioeconomic. You don't see wealthy minorities shooting people up and doing this. You know, Ben Carson's not sitting on a roof with a sniper rifle.
Right.
All right? It's socioeconomic.
See, and when you hear some of the raging liberals, now, that's why I use the word liberal. There are some moderate Democrats, right, that might be more of like a John F. Kennedy, right, a moderate, not a liberal. But when you listen to, let's say, Rachel Maddow, or you listen to some other ones, they are so diametrically opposed to what I think middle America believes. And what did middle America do in this last election? It gave Trump the election. Michigan, Wisconsin, Ohio, the Rust Belt. Right? Now, Michigan is not any less American than California. Wisconsin is not any less American than New York. The big numbers came in from California and New York. For Hillary Clinton, right? That's why he lost the popular vote. She got like 4 million more votes in California, right? California is so liberal, it's ridiculous, right? And that's why it would take a guy like Reagan, who had a second term, to get California.
Right.
I honestly believe, now I called the election the first time correctly and for all the right reasons. I predict if Donald Trump does a great job, he's got a chance at picking off a state, like, and he doesn't even have to do that to win re-election, like a New York, a California. If he does right, and in fact, I forget what company it is now going to do some kind of work in Buffalo. The upstate region of New York needs it. All right? You do right by New York, they're going to reward you, just like they did Ronald Reagan.
Right. First of all, if Trump does a decent job, nobody's going to have a chance against him the next time if he decides to run. It's not going to be his first go-around. This man knows what he's doing, and he's already putting the ground game in place, by the way.
Right.
That's why he's talking to these black leaders here and there. Even he's not stupid. Even like it seems like it's
he got more than Romney did.
It seems like black. It seems negligible, but he's talking to, you know, the Jim Browns,
mm-hmm.
right? He's a leader in the black community. Even the Kanye West that are
Don
out there,
King?
He knows what he's doing. He's putting this stuff. And every one of them that leaves Trump's house says they have a newfound respect for the man. And wow, they're enamored with this and that. He knows what he's doing. He's setting it up now.
Right.
He's not,
and the black leadership want to get behind the winner. It doesn't matter what color the person is. They want to get behind the winner. And that's why when Donald Trump boldly said, what have you got to lose? Basically, what the hell have you got to lose? What have you got in those inner cities by 50, 90, 110 years of Democratic rule? You have nothing.
Right. A couple of things out there, Phil. Number one, Eric, a long time ago, Eric,
our Eric,
said, yes. I think he means it's Eric's idea. We're paying for it. And Eric, you know what, Eric? I think it's a good idea, to be honest with you. And well, you know what? We'll see if it's a good idea at the end of the month. If it's a good idea, Eric, great idea. If it's not, it's all your idea. All right?
You know what Eric's going to do?
But that is a good idea, remember, Eric. I like it.
Remember Happy Days? And they were going to have a rigged, like a raffle. And they had the winning ticket like taped to the bottom of something. So someone had to reach in and grab the thing. And I think that's what Eric's going to do.
Yeah.
So when he's going to reach down there and it's going to be like, I can't believe I won.
I got to tell you,
no, he wouldn't do
about
that.
Six members of my family have been doing it. So what if they win? We should have a thing where they're not eligible. Right?
Well, the big warnings if you're related or
yeah, we should have
family
that.
Members.
We didn't put that disclosure. Mm-hmm. So anyway, here we go. Let's see what we got here. Sean joined the media's assert. We did that. Frank, sorry I'm late. We did that one. Marissa is on fire. It's the media. Sean is advertising our text. Thanks, Sean. 31996. Text 31996. Then in the message, type internet radio. Do that once a day or just once.
We got to tell Eric the next time he's going to do anything when we have to pay out money, let us know first. Okay?
Yeah. Yeah. Then
I think we could swing $100, but if he does something bigger than that, I want to know about it.
Marissa says, you don't hear White Lives Matter or White Entertainment TV or White History Month. It's the damn media. Sean chimes in. He opines.
Opines, huh?
Because it's racist to say White Lives Matter, but it's okay to say Black Lives Matter, which is BS. I couldn't agree more, Sean. All lives matter, unless you're a jerk. I'm not a jerk. Well said, Phil. Whatever Phil just said. Well said, Phil. I don't know what you just said.
I said many things.
I know.
I don't remember.
Whatever you said, it was well said.
Okay. And there was a delay there. That's why I said.
Okay.
You got to let me know these things in real time so I can know what I said. Okay, Frank?
Please? You got it.
Okay.
You got it.
If he said something good, I want to know about it. Please.
Yeah.
Tell me. I can make a note of it.
So I got something for you, Phil.
What do you got?
You want? I spoke about this the other day, but since you are an attorney, so there's a guy who was in prison for 15 years, all right, for murder and sexual assault. He was exonerated. DNA evidence and a suicide note from his brother, Tom, where Tom admits to doing it. Some brother he is. He let his brother take the freaking brunt of his crime, right? So now he gets released. Another guy is wrongfully convicted of raping an elderly woman. They could have been prevented. If not for something that I have been crying for, and we've spoken about
it. Videotaping confessions?
See, that's why Phil's an attorney, everybody. All right? That's why this guy...
I can read you.
This guy knows. All right? Yes, they weren't videotaped.
You could have made me look silly and said no.
And that's a big part of false confessions. Like, false confessions can be avoided if they were videotaped. Right. They're saying that one of the things that the jurors didn't see was how they were threatened, not fed or given water and things like that. It did happen to me, but we'll leave my story. I always talk about me, Phil, so we won't.
It's all about you, Frank.
But one guy makes a good point. In another case, the police officer questioned the innocent person and then questioned the real guilty person.
Right.
And the guy says, well, don't take my word for it. If it was videotaped, the jurors could have seen. Like, you decide who's lying. There's the guilty guy and there's me. We're both a question. Just look at the videotape. Let it roll. And everybody says money, but, you know, with digital recorders.
No, it's
$30. I mean, use your phone to record. Like, not that you want to do that, but my point is.
Look, they have dash cams all over the place now.
It's like they're cheap, like, to videotape confessions. And here's another couple of lives that are just straight up. I just cannot wrap my head around the fact. It really bothers me. The only reason I'm not screaming like I used to is because you're here. It's absurd that they don't video. And they're saying, well, you should videotape the more serious crimes. And like 21 states.
Murders, rape, why not?
I think you should videotape. If a person is handcuffed and they're chained to a floor, whatever they're chained to, and it's them and the police and nobody else. Then
even misdemeanors, Frank?
Yeah.
As a practical matter, that might be extending it a little bit too much.
But what's the cost? Who cares? Mm-hmm. Who cares what it is? I don't care if it's a violation. I don't care. Is it out there? All right, I'll read that. Okay, thank you. I don't care if it's you're crossing the street, you're jaywalking. If it's you, a civilian, okay, your attorney's not there. How many times have somebody's been picked up and you were in the interrogation room with
them?
Well,
let me say this. Look.
But listen, hang on a second.
Okay.
It's somebody who has no idea what's going on, right? Most people, they get arrested. I don't know. Like, who knows what – I would assume the first time they've been arrested. Is that accurate? I don't know.
Say it again?
If somebody gets arrested, chances are it's the first time they're arrested. Does that make sense?
No.
No, they've been arrested more than that?
Could be.
All right. So listen, when I was in the interrogation room, I didn't know what was going on. I was outmanned. Okay? Mm. I'm a pretty smart guy. I was a high school principal. All right. I don't know if I'm pretty smart, but I was educated. Okay. it was me in an unknown world and two police officers.
You know, and this was before WLINY. So you weren't informed.
Exactly.
To the extent our listeners are.
Exactly. So my point is, it levels the playing field. I think it should have been. And that was those were misdemeanors. Yes, it should have been videotaped. I didn't know. What else do I have to go on? What is it? You know damn straight at a Huntley hearing, which is where they do the Miranda and sworn statements are admissible, right?
Right.
Most of the time, they're going to take the police officer's word for it, unless it's some egregious thing, it's so obvious.
Most of the time, that's true. I've won a few in my day, but right.
So my point is, just videotape it. It levels the play. How else do I get fair? Like, how else would I have had my playing field leveled? Thank God the DA in my case came out and said, hey, there's a Miranda violation. Mm-hmm. Or else that would have been an uphill battle for me.
Yeah, but that was Carmen Miranda. It was a little bit different.
Yeah, but what were you going to say? Go ahead.
Okay, now I want to tell an interesting story. I was watching the OJ, a documentary on OJ, one I had never seen before. And this goes to show you the lengths to which the attorneys representing OJ went to get this guy off. Remember the jury was brought to Rockingham, which is his house, and they wanted to talk about what happened outside. The defense wanted to bring the jury inside. Marsha Clark said, why? There's no need. Nothing happened in the house that's relevant with respect to this case.
I hate that.
Now, Marsha had been in the house before. And in that house, if you walked into that house, if you didn't know who OJ was, you would think that it was a white man's house. What?
I'm sorry, Phil. What do I do if Ed Vilbig is calling me right now?
Ed, if you're listening to the show, come on at 9 o'clock. It's a little bit early.
All right.
I'm not done with my story yet.
Go ahead.
Please.
Go. I'm sorry.
Okay. And see, I lost my train of thought. So if you went into that house, you would believe that it was a white man's house. According to the people that were in the house, all the pictures were of white people, an OJ with a white person. The defense, and they interviewed one of Johnny Cochran's associates, and he said, you know what they did, Frank?
They
took down most of the pictures that were in the house, and they got pictures. They said OJ probably didn't even remember he had, and they put up pictures. So it was all black because why? The jury was mostly black.
Right.
So Marsha got very angry and she talked to Judge Ito. They had a little hearing on the lawn and he says, no, we're going to let them in.
Judge Ito.
So the jurors got the impression that he was a black man. They knew he's black, but, you know, in other words, surrounding himself with black people. Now, maybe that doesn't make a difference to white people. Apparently, the attorneys thought it did. So Judge Ito, was wrong to allow that to happen.
Right.
Because once it was brought to his attention, and I don't think the defense denied it, first of all, there was no reason to go into that house. Right? It'd be like if they were investigating your case and they say, let's go into your office. You know, I mean, what's relevant and what's not relevant is pretty generally straightforward.
Right. You know?
Did anything happen in the house? Okay. Now, if you're going to bring them into the house, don't let the defense taint the jury pool.
Right.
When you had like eight black people.
Right.
So I thought that was very interesting. And it was confirmed, because I had heard the rumor in other documentaries, but it was confirmed by one of the attorneys for Johnny Cochran. Because I think when they did the documentary, Johnny had passed away already.
Right.
But for that to come out, and he said it with such pride. Like, as an attorney, I will fight for my client, but I don't think I would do something like that. I can't imagine.
I hope not.
Me being caught up to the point where I'm going to try to taint the jury pool.
Right.
And the judge let him get away with it.
Right.
Look, there was a lot of things in that trial that shouldn't have happened. You know what I think we're going to do at some point?
Go ahead.
One last thing. What I'd like to do is either this show or another show have like a night at the movies and talk about cases, because we like to talk about law and people like to do it.
Let's do
it. And you and I could talk about, let's say, My Cousin Vinny. And there are things in that movie that were accurate, that could happen in real. There are things that could never happen.
Right.
Or not in the universe of a normal judge and a normal jury or a normal setup.
There's a lot of good movies with those scenes.
Right. Or even Seinfeld. Remember when they had the trial?
Right.
There are things I could pick apart that, let's say you watching it, maybe you know now, but you couldn't have a good Samaritan law in America. France has it. But imagine if you saw a crime and the law said you had to go try to stop it.
Forget it.
What are you going to do? Get shot?
Yeah.
Now, maybe that would be the wise thing to do. They can't make you. Like Johnny Cochran said, this is America. They can't make you do anything. It wasn't Johnny Cochran.
Jackie.
It was Jackie Childs.
Jackie. Yeah.
You don't have to do anything to help anybody. So I think that would be a good... Guys, if you're listening, chime in. Do you think that would be a good idea to have a night at the movies where we could even have... Once Frank figures out how to use the TV behind me...
Right.
We could have, movies
it's
on
black
there.
Black and white, yeah.
And we could have My Cousin Vinny and all the other fun movies.
Marissa. Let me answer Marissa, then you can bring us out, Phil.
All right?
And Marissa, here's what I would think. Marissa's asking, Frank, I want to hear what your thoughts and Phil's thoughts are about Burke beating the crap out of Loeb. Would he have done it if the camera had been recording?
That's an easy one.
Well,
of course not.
He wouldn't have done it. If the camera's recording, of course not. But if he did, he would have broken the camera. Obviously, the guy orchestrated a complete cover-up involving the whole Suffolk County PD. Yeah. So if he did with the camera running, he would have tried to break the camera or get rid of the stuff, and everybody would have covered for
him.
You
never see it.
And everybody would have covered for him. That's why they're in trouble. But probably he wouldn't have did it. That's an easy one. Mm. Ed just called up, and I ignored him again. I'm going to bring Ed on. I got to go, but I'll be in the show for the next...
If you bring him in, you're going to keep him on? Ed.
Yeah, I don't.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know.
You going to stick around?
I have to.
Okay, good.
I'm doing the show, everybody. Hey, guys, we are officially... Ed, hang on a second. Hang on. Ed, hang on 1 second, buddy.
I am here for you.
All right, hang on.
Eddie Vilbig, how you doing?
All right. You want to get us
Hello,
out of
from Atlanta.
Hang Ed? On. Ed, get out of here. Wait.
Hang on 1 second.
I'm not going anywhere.
All right, put him on mute, see?
Okay.
Take us out, Phil. Okay. This is choppy, guys. Go.
Okay. Listen, I'd like to thank everybody for listening and watching tonight. You're a great audience. I'm glad for the input. I like that. You should do that more. And I want to hear from people that disagree with what Frank and I espouse, because that makes a little better radio than saying Phil and Frank are right on point. I love that. I want to hear that, but I want to hear the opposing view so we can chop into little pieces. Just kidding. I want to hear the opposing view. Make your case. State your case. I invite you to do that. So next week, I want to hear from people. If you have a liberal friend, tell your liberal friend to call the show.
All right, guys. I am out of here for the show, but I am behind the booth. It's going to be Phil and Ed Vilbig, Ed from Atlanta.
The right perspective.
Standing on Principle is out. I'm out. I am going to sit silently, and I will read your comments. Take care. Brush your hair.
Good night, everybody. Song going, I like it. Otherwise, I gotta listen to Ed. I'll let you know when.
That's Ace Frehley, everybody. I want everybody singing this.
Here I am, in the city.
Almost.
Back in New York, groove.
Yeah.
I'm back.
Back in the New York groove.
I'm back. Back in the New York groove.
I'm attorney Phil Jacino, and I don't even know where I am. Frank, listening to
you're
Frank
on Long Island somewhere.
I'm back in the New York groove here on WLINY. It's called The Right Perspective with my buddy and my former roommate, Ed Vilbig. Ed, how you doing?
Good evening from Atlanta. It's good to be back home.
You know, I was going to say to Frank, my daughter used to do this years ago. I used to say, Frank, do you know who sings that song?
Kiss, right? That was Ace Frehley?
Let's keep it that way.
He got me. That's the oldest joke in a book, and he fell for it. He got me.
Okay.
Good job, Phil.
My daughter's too sophisticated, and I can't get her on that. But listen, also, I love that song, but I heard a rumor that Ed Vilbig wanted Cat and I Joe. And I said, we're gonna stick with this one. We're always going to end with Hawaii Five-0 because
that sounds good to me.
That was Ed's favorite show. He made me watch that. Book
that
him,
was
Dano.
So long ago. We are now in 2017. First thing I want to say is I like what Bernie Sanders and Governor Cuomo in New York. They want to give an opportunity for people to go to college, public colleges for free. I went to Stony Brook. I think that's a great thing.
For free? Who's gonna? You know who's paying for it?
Exactly. That's the part no one wants to talk about. I figured we'd talk about that tonight.
Were you being sarcastic or you meant you really liked it?
The deficit is what? How many trillions of dollars now? $20 trillion?
Going up.
Now, if it doesn't raise the deficit, I'm all for it. But you cannot put this burden on the taxpayer. That's right. I don't understand. I was looking for details. There's no details any place on the internet about this, paying for college it sounds great. Where's the money going to come from?
Well, you know what? In a couple of weeks, we're going to bring on the dean of Suffolk Community College. I met him the other day. In fact, he came into the studio, Frank and Ed, and he was impressed. He used to be a DJ, he said, years ago, I think in Maryland, and he was impressed with the setup. We might be teaming up with Suffolk Community College at some point. But the point I'm making is this. Think about it. Suffolk Community College is a little bit over $2,000 a semester.
Right.
So if you're a young kid, let's say you come from a poor family. First of all, you're probably getting financial aid. But let's say you're a middle-class kid. $2,000, you should be able to work and save up enough money with books and all that, maybe $2,500. So you're going to get a quality education, an associate degree, for about $10,000 over, right, let's say, a 2-3-year period, depending on how long it takes.
Well, you Stony Brook's about $6,000.
Okay, but that's Stony Brook. But I'm saying go to Suffolk for 2 years. My daughter went to Suffolk for 2 years. Then she went to Stony Brook, graduated with a degree in business. My other child, middle kid, went to Suffolk, and she ended up as an honors student over at John Jay.
And that's a great deal compared to these
private
institutions like Fordham, where we went. What is it, $50,000 a year?
If you live on campus, $55,000.
The only one that can afford that is Frank. I mean, Frank could send people to Fordham. We couldn't. I can't afford it.
It wasn't 55 when I went, I'll tell you that.
But my point being is, I don't 6,000. When I saw the statistics today, to go to Stony Brook is $6,000. It wasn't when I went.
It's
even want to mention the year.
It's more than that.
It was so long ago. It wasn't. It was maybe $2,000-$3,000.
Frank,
that's the steal to go to college for $6,000.
Am I allowed to chime in on
your
show?
Yeah, sure.
Let me chime in for 1 second. Governor Cuomo wants free. You heard that?
Yeah.
It's gonna be free college.
I think. Look. If you're really poor, you know you're going to get financial aid. If you're really rich, it's not an issue. The middle class is the one, especially the lower middle class, that really, let's say, need a little bit of assistance. But again, if you can't get a job to scrape up
$2,500,
let's say $2,500 a semester, finish at Suffolk Community College, get your associate degree, go to Stony Brook, work. I worked when I was in high school a little bit. I worked when I was in college. I did security work. I worked when I was in law school. I did security work. I even worked as an assistant DA doing security because the pay was so lousy when I first started out. You do what you have to do. I think a student should be invested in his income. I don't think there should be freebies, and again, unless it's warranted. You know, and again, if let's just say your father was a cop who was killed in the job or a fireman. They have all these funds that can help you out. The 9/11 fund. So many kids are educated. Great. Educated because, let's say, one of their parents was killed. But
well,
you
Bernie
should be able to get
coming,
that money.
The whole country is going
to
be doing this, so I'm
well,
curious to see how.
I don't like
this?
It. I don't like it.
I want to see who's going to pay for it. I mean, I know Frank
and you and I will pay for it.
Most of us can't.
100, 200. What would you say? I'm counting my money. What'd you say?
No, but it's just I'm sitting there watching TV, and again, this is just the Democrats, I think, trying to derail the Republicans from their big day on January 20th. The devil's in the details. How are you going to pay for this? Obama has taken the deficit now to almost $20 trillion, and I know for people that are listening that are, you know, diehard Democrats and liberals and down here in Atlanta, Obama's done some good things, but he's done some bad things. And you cannot – there's nothing to debate here that the deficit is now $20 trillion. It was not even $5 trillion when he took over. So that's non-debatable.
Right. But so that's why you have the liberals, because, look, it sounds great to millennials. Think about it. If someone said to you – I'll give you an example. If someone said to you – Eric, Frank, or Ed, you know what? We're going to give free housing. We're going to give free cars. We're going to give a free cell phone, like the Obama phone. Remember? You get Obama phone. You get a package of benefits. You might – I wouldn't, because I want to work for what I get. But there are a lot of people out there that would say, you want to give me all that free stuff? Sure, why not?
Well, here's what Obama said. You know, he was asked what he was going to be doing, you know, when he left the White House, and he was talking about the Democratic Party. He wanted to be a counsel to them. And he said, quote, "Democrats are characterized as coastal, liberal, latte sipping, politically correct, out of touch folk."
Who said this?
And this came from Obama. This was in USA Today.
President Obama said this.
Unlike I know Phil does a lot of preparation for the show. I know, Frank sometimes has, you know, he has people behind the scenes getting all that paperwork.
He has a big staff, Frank.
He's got a whole research department.
The Frank Ventura Show has about five people.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. I'm here by myself. So I was reading, I always try to go onto these liberal sites to see USA Today is like number one. And I was reading this about Obama, what he's going to do when he leaves office. And he said he wants to counsel, you know, work with the Democratic Party. Obviously, he wanted to, hoping that, you know, Clinton was going to win where he could just, you know, advise Clinton. And, sure. But now his role has changed. He has to basically try to defend his legacy, which is going to go up in.
Well, that's why he's staying in Washington, D.C.
Exactly. But when they asked him, I mean, he said that this is I took this down. Democrats are characterized as coastal, liberal, latte sipping, politically correct, out of touch folk. You know, I lifted that from the whole, you know, it goes on.
I can't
on,
believe President Obama said that.
Yes. Look it up on USA Today, because they were asking about his plans and what went wrong with the Democrats. And he was talking about that the Democrats are only appealing to New York and California, and that's not the whole state. And also, there was a good thing. I hate to plug HBO, but on Vice, they did a special.
Phil calls it Home Box Office.
Home Box Office.
Home Box Office.
Okay, let's call it that. they did a report on House Divided, and it was pretty good. They talked a lot about the differences in Congress, and they had President Obama on there, and he admitted to some of the things that didn't go right. We have all these fanatic liberals where think he can't do anything wrong, but then he comes out and says there's some things that are wrong with the Democratic Party.
Well, look,
I find that real interesting.
Last show, Frank and I were talking about it, and we said the reason Democrats
last week. Yes, you guys cut me off. I couldn't even get on.
Oh, I'm
you
sorry.
Took the whole show.
Blame Frank. He controls
people,
the phone.
People cried here in Atlanta, by the way.
For those of you just joining in late, you're listening to The Right Perspective with Phil Jacinto, attorney. Ed, how did you get introduced to it? Educator? Administrator? What are you?
I don't know. Well, I was an administrator.
Ed from Atlanta. He's an education administrator in Atlanta. That's right. We're a syndicated national show. Mm-hmm. And I am behind the boards just minding my own business. But this is The Right Perspective. Phil Jacinto, Ed from Atlanta. And they give me a little politics and social issues around the nation.
And if you have any comments, whether you agree with us or disagree with us, please chime in. Frank is going to be reading us.
Frank is doing
any
a great
comments.
Job.
I mind my own business on this show, everybody. So I'm just going to read your comments. Go.
Frank is doing a great job, I got to say.
Yes, he is. Especially the music. He's like a DJ there. But also, I know he's getting a big fat check, and I need to talk about compensation. I will definitely get with finance this week, because we got to work something out. This has taken a lot of my time. I start preparing around 3 in the afternoon for this show. And
well, maybe you should contact Bernie Sanders. Maybe
Ed, close your eyes. What do you see?
You don't want to know.
I heard Vilbig does the show in his underwear.
Oh, God.
Do you want? I'll send pictures. Hold on.
You got to see what Frank's wearing right now. Jesus Christ.
All right. Now, my parents are listening.
Hey, close your eyes. What do you see?
Back on track. A lot of issues to talk about.
All right. What do you got? Go.
All right, next thing is I was watching a commercial by Coca-Cola, and, you know, they make the whole world sing and everything is happy, and they show, you know, the Muslims, everybody's smiling and everything, and, you know, trying to blend everybody together, and, you know, nice commercial around, you know, for New Year's. And I'm saying to myself, this is not reality here. There are, what, 1% or 2% of the Muslim population want to kill us. If you take 2% of 20 million, what does that come to? Like 2 million people? That are out to harm the United States. So I have a fundamental disagreement with this whole thing where we have this peace-loving Muslim movement in this country. I don't see it, or around the world. I see, you know, people getting killed on New Year's Eve in Turkey, all kind of, France has terrorist attacks, Germany. And the liberal media is trying to push this peace-loving, you know, Muslim image, and I don't see it.
Well, you notice one thing. You notice how the politicians, when they bring these people in, they're sending them as far away from those liberal centers, New York and California. They're sending them to Michigan and Minnesota. They're sending them over there. And it's changing the fabric of those communities. And those people don't like it.
I think they're going to have to do, I agree with President-elect Trump, they're going to have to do something with, immigration. You're going to have severe vetting. You just cannot let people come in here who want to destroy this country. It doesn't make any sense to me.
I have a suggestion. How about they follow the law?
The law is in place.
Frank is pointing to
Well, they can go to Chicago. I know you guys talked about it at length on a
that would be a powder keg.
What's that?
I said, that would be a powder keg. Frank, you appointed me?
Well, no. I was going to say, Ed brings up, you know, all these people coming in, you know, 2% of whatever he just said. All these people coming in, like if these people had the open borders, for all you environmentalists, where are we putting them? How many forests are we knocking down? Which state park are we going to get rid of? Yellowstone? Which national park are we getting rid of? Who's building the schools that hate the United States?
And we let them in unvetted. You walk right across the border.
My point is, besides the dangers, it's not practical. It can't happen. There's no way to put them.
And look, we know exactly what could happen. Just look to Europe. Just look to Germany. Just look to France. We know. It's like a crystal ball.
It happened here in Orlando.
It didn't work there.
It happened here.
Orlando, San Bernardino. It happens. And look at San Bernardino. Somebody got in. In Facebook, they were espousing certain
ideology. And the media doesn't want to connect it together. Why isn't the media connecting the dots?
We need people more to not be afraid to say something, because there were neighbors of those people in San Bernardino. They didn't want to say anything because they didn't want to come across as racist or prejudiced. You have to, you know, the New York, if you see something, say something. Mm-hmm. If you see a neighbor, I don't care if it's Swedish or Italian or Greek, and something is suspicious, especially if you think they're doing something that is against the law, report them. You know, don't remain silent, because look what happens. Then after it happens, oh my God, I should have said something. No, don't put yourself in that position. You see something suspicious, say something.
Well, I know Italy, I was reading the other day, Italy has zero tolerance for illegals that commit crimes. They're automatically deported. There's no discussion, zero tolerance.
You mean
tolerance.
They don't have a sanctuary city?
Oh, you go to Chicago. By the way, how many murders this weekend in Chicago? We have to three. Is it four? It's either three or four. I was reading it before. Today's what, January 3rd?
Well, look, it's two a day, so do the math. Saturday, Sunday, that's four there.
Now, my question is, this is for my friends in Atlanta here. I know I'll get all these nasty text messages for the next week. Why do you keep voting Democratic in Chicago when you have this type of murder, carnage going on up there? You keep putting Rahm Emanuel in, who's Obama's friend. Hey, he's done a terrible job. Why are you continuing to elect Democrats in that city when it's a complete disaster?
Because they're told you have to vote Democrat. It's going to make it better. And maybe in the last 70 or 80 years it hasn't happened. But you know what? Maybe the next Democrat's going to help us. It's a fallacy. It's not going to happen.
Atlanta's mayor is up. Kasim Reed, he's done his two terms, so he can't run again. It's time for Atlanta to look at putting a Republican mayor in. The chances of that happening are so slim, but let's look at it. Let's look at some of the things that can change and make Atlanta a better place. Same thing with Chicago. New York, de Blasio's got to go. They got to start looking at putting somebody in there that can make some changes.
Well, you know what you need?
Just keep putting Democrats and doing the same old thing is not helping.
You need a bold Republican, somebody cut, let's say, from the same cloth as a Donald Trump. to get up there at a podium and say, look, we're going to make some sweeping changes. How have things been going so far?
If you want to keep doing the same thing. 700 murders in, what is it, 768, I think it's the actual number last year.
In Chicago? 762.
762. I was close. I should have wrote that down, so I didn't prepare enough, because I don't have a full staff like you guys to do help me with the research.
Well, 713 shooting, but 762 murders in Chicago.
That's one city.
You've got all of liberal Atlanta to help
you. All these Democratic cities around Baltimore, Washington, D.C., Atlanta, all where Democrats are in control. Look what's going on.
Edward Munoz, that's Eddie to us,
right,
says F de Blasio.
They need to get it.
He better be a one-termer. That's all I got to say.
Yeah. I have a feeling. But, you know, New York is so liberal and Democrat. You got people to go in there. They cover their eyes and just push the blue lever. And I think that's a big problem.
Right. And I said this. Look, I said this many times before. And most people probably wouldn't say this. But I think if you're the Democratic Party, you don't have respect for those people in the inner city. How could you? How could you be a mayor of a city where two people a day are getting killed, where the population is roughly 2.7 million? So it's about a third of the size of New York City. Mm-hmm. How do you look yourself? If I was a mayor and I saw that kind of carnage.
It's disgraceful. I don't want to cut you up, but my blood pressure is going through. It's disgraceful. And then to turn around and say the day after Trump wins the election, we're a sanctuary city. You'll be safe here. If you commit a crime, you can come to us.
His priorities are misplaced. Great.
That is just I could not believe that he came out and did that. And I think he did that to support his friend Obama, who, you know, basically his legacy is coming to an end
and he believes
in a matter
it.
Of a few weeks.
Emmanuel's a very liberal man.
Comment in the chat room, fellas. Top 20 largest cities in America. Top 20 largest cities in America that have the most violent crime are all run by Democrats. Chicago, Detroit, Oakland, Houston, Baltimore, Birmingham, Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
No surprise there.
That's
right on the money. Because the thing is, with the Democrat, they unfortunately minorities just vote Democratic. They don't look at any other candidates, and I think that's a big problem. I have friends, people that are listening to us right now. They are so anti-Trump. No matter what he does, it's not good enough. But if Obama did it right, then it's great. We got to get out of that mentality.
Well, I think Donald Trump is going to do what he feels is right, regardless of what other people think. And you need a leader like that. You can't have a leader that puts his finger up and says, how are the winds blowing today? You have to have a leader that has an agenda. Reagan was a very principled politician. You could disagree with him, and he would tell you, you know what, I don't care. This is what I'm going to do because this is what I believe. I think Donald Trump is cut from the same cloth as a Ronald Reagan. People thought I was nuts saying stuff like that before, and now I think they look at it and say, this is a game changer. A Donald Trump. He's a guy that loves.
Such bad shape that
right. But
middle class is done.
Right, but he loves the military. Donald Trump. I'm not saying Obama hated the military, but he acted as though he was indifferent to it. Donald Trump loves law enforcement. This is a guy that the police can get behind and say he has our back. Donald Trump has their back. Barack Obama didn't have their back. He would send people to. That fellow that was killed, the big guy that was shot and killed, and at first they thought the cop was Ferguson in Ferguson, Missouri.
Oh, yeah. He sent Eric Holder out there.
Right. And yet a cop gets killed, and it was almost like, okay, so? And he would support. I believe that Black Lives Matter have been to the White House on a number of occasions. Right.
Well, there's no debating this. Whoever's listening.
And I personally think it's a terrorist group. I'm going to say
race relations are 1,000 times worse now than they were 8 years ago under Obama. And as I said, you know, and I tell people this all the time, I voted for Obama the first time because our country was in economic crisis and the middle class was in trouble back then. But 8 years later, it's a lot worse now.
And the other fallacy is this. If you are a true leader, all right, you're not going to say, I want to help the black man. I want to help the white man. You want to help America because a rising tide lifts all boats. If you get it, if you make a better economy, let's say in the inner cities, and those kids get jobs, they're less likely to commit crime. I know that's an oversimplification. You're not going to go in there, open a McDonald's, and these drug dealers are going to take a $10 an hour job.
Right.
I understand that's really not what I'm talking about. But if you make things safer for them, just like Manhattan seemed to be a lost cause years ago. And then Giuliani came in, a Republican, and he cleaned it up. So I don't want to hear these liberals saying, well, it wasn't all him. I understand that. But he was the leader that made changes that brought in industry. Go to Times Square. You couldn't do that years ago. Not unless you wanted to get shot or your kids wanted to see a peep show.
Frank was used to go. Frank, I'm sure, was down there many times.
He was there for the peep shows, but that's not really what I'm talking about.
I was the peep shows.
Right.
Everybody, thanks for tuning in. For those of you that tuned in late, you're listening to The Right Perspective with Phil Jacinto and Ed Vilbig from Atlanta. We are national now. That's right. You're listening to WLINY.com, Long Island, New York, the world, America's number one internet radio TV station.
Frank, I even heard. You are a good announcer, I got to say.
Well, I am Frank Vetra. You can't see me. I'm in the booth subbing in, guest producing the show.
But I want to say something. I even heard that our signal reaches other planets. Now, I don't know if there's anybody there to receive it, but that's what I heard.
Well, pretty soon, Whoopi Goldberg will be there since Trump won.
Oh, yeah.
Hang on. So we got some comments here, everybody.
How about Rosie? What's Rosie up to?
I thought
Rosie
she's in Canada.
Isn't she moving?
She should have.
Here we go. Ready?
These people, they just like to say things just to get themselves heard. I mean, shut up. You lost the election. Mobilize for 2 years and 4 years. If you don't like what you see, go get back to the grassroots. Get the rest of it. Besides New York and California, you have to appeal to more country, more states. You can't appeal just the two states and expect them to win the White House.
Get the hook out. Here we go. So I'm just going to rattle this off. Eddie, City councils and mayors run those cities. We're way back, guys. He will end the DOJ investigations, whatever you were talking about. Michael Brown, whatever you were talking about.
That's right.
Edward Munoz, yes. Whatever he was yes into. State over White House. That's the playbook for Sol Alinsky. Communist Manifesto. Division among the people in every facet. You know what? I think Eddie should probably think about having his own show.
Didn't he once have a show on the station?
Oh, yeah.
I believe he did. That's right. It was pretty good.
Yeah.
I got to say, he should come back. We got a time slot
Welcome
available.
Aboard, Bonnie. Bonnie Lawson joined us.
Hey, Bonnie. How are you? So what's on your mind? What do you think you agree with what Frank and Ed and I are saying? I think you would.
Bonnie agrees. I am the peep show. I'm just kidding.
Frank, you can't afford the quarter, though.
That up. Hey, we're not ignoring. Hey, for those of you, because I know most of you guys just listen. You don't watch because you minimize the screen. Call in number 888-583-9930, extension 100.
See, I think people
and
like to
sure
do
the
chat room. It's more
people
fun for
they
them.
They do.
I get but most people they can't get through.
But most people do just listen, you know.
Yeah, but people can't get through from Atlanta. Make sure you pick up. When you see the light blink, that means you hit the call.
Yes, that's the problem. We need to get the computer screen forward so I don't
see. You're so engrossed looking my way that you don't get the call.
Key word is grossed, everybody.
Engrossed, they say. Gee, thanks.
But the thing is, now, one thing I do have to say, now the Republicans control. They have the House.
They got the
presidency. They have to produce some results for the American taxpayer. Notice I'm saying the word taxpayer. If they don't, it's not going to be pleasant, for the midterm elections and for the next presidential race. Right. If Donald Trump can pull it off, he's got, all the pieces are coming together in the puzzle. They've got to get things done. They have to, do something with this deficit. They got to stop illegal immigration. They got to fix the tax structure. They've got to fix education. So, I mean, he was right when he talked about, saying we're not going to deal with this ethics thing. Put that on the back burner. There's so many things. And Obamacare, that has to be done. I can't believe people's deductibles.
Well, they want to attack that in the first 100 days, but they got to have an alternative. They got to come up with something.
Right. But the Democrats are already starting the nonsense where all 20 million people are going to be on, going to be kicked off health care. Well, what was working before Obamacare maybe needs to come back. If you can't afford health care, that's the way you got to get a job. You just can't expect the taxpayers to have. Why should a taxpayer have a $5,000 to $10,000 deductible, and then
that's
someone
ridiculous.
Else goes in there and gets free health care?
I want more competition. I want a company in Jersey to be able to sell me insurance if that's the best deal, right? Because competition is going to bring the price down.
They've got to do something with it, and I think that's one of the reasons the Democrats lost the White House because of their policies. It wasn't because of the Russians. They tried the recount, that didn't work. They blamed the Russians, that didn't work.
It was the Electoral College.
Trying to harass those members. Millions of dollars spent on trying to get
And she
those,
lost five. He only lost two.
Yeah, exactly. But you see what? But nobody wants to look at the policy. Most Americans do not disagree. Most Americans do not agree with the platform of the Democrats. There was another poll that came out today, and I was laughing because it was a Gallup poll that says only 46% of the public believes that Trump will be able to handle international crisis. And the commentator laughed and said, who is going to believe this poll? The Gallup has gotten nothing right with Trump during the primaries, during the election.
Most polls were wrong.
Every poll was wrong, and now Gallup's at it again, saying, you know, with 46%, and the commentator was like, just take this poll and just throw it away.
One second, Ed.
I just want to apologize. We just got a call. I'm new behind the booth, everybody. I'm just learning the ropes here. I don't know how to take a call because Ed is on the line. I don't know how to take a group call.
So we got to get rid of Ed? No.
you want me to hang up?
My show. I got to ask Eric if there's...
Do you want me to hang up? You guys?
No, not at all. I don't know how to... Sorry, guys. I don't know how to take a group.
We'll figure it out. But in the meantime, send us something in the chat room.
Yeah, right.
We'll call it out.
Yeah.
Right. But we definitely need to take calls because I know it's funny because once we get off the air, the texts start. People complaining about some of the things that we say, and if they could, and I've told people, this is what I like. I'll get a text, and you know, I'll meet them for lunch or something, and they'll tell me how they feel. I said, well, why don't you call the show? Oh, I'm not calling. So, but if you,
a lot of people tell me the same thing. They're kind of shy, but in the chat room, you can speak your mind. Frank will read it, and we'll discuss it. I want to see more people that have a different position, because this is how we have a debate. If you think
wrong? And I am an independent. I just, you know, and I've told said this many times, I am not 100% supporter of Trump. Some of the things he said during the primaries was just awful. But
water under the bridge.
It's water under the bridge, and he is now the president, and you have to get behind him. You got people that want him to fail, so America fails, so then the Democrats get in power. That makes no sense. And I'm hoping that this Congress doesn't do some of the things that the last Congress did. We have to try to make things better for the people that are out there, the millions of people that are trying to make a living, support their families, and are having a tough time because wages are not going anywhere.
It's called the Ferguson effect.
People losing jobs. You have immigrants coming over that are taking jobs, so it's less jobs to everybody else. Wages are being pushed down.
Well, look,
something's got to give.
I want to make an important point. Donald Trump, like I said before, has an agenda, and he's going to follow that. But here's a guy with an open mind because he met with Gore. He met with some people that I couldn't believe. That he did. And I didn't criticize him for it, but remember he met with Gore, he met with some people that were way to the left of him. Now you gotta understand something. Donald Trump may be a fiscal conservative, but I'm not so sure he's a social conservative because he came from New York. Even Giuliani, remember in the primaries, that's why he couldn't get traction, because usually you have to be a conservative and then run toward the middle. You have people that come from New York where they might be more open to gay marriage. They might be open to other things that a staunch conservative, let's say from the Bible Belt, wouldn't agree with. So let's not forget, I think Trump is going to be somewhat socially moderate, fiscally conservative, and he has an agenda. Yes, Frank?
Eddie just spoke with Steve Loomis, president of the Cleveland Police Union, and crime is skyrocketing in Cleveland.
In Cleveland.
Just so you know.
Are you surprised?
And if you don't know, now you know.
What is that? What's that from?
That's Biggie Smalls, rapper.
Okay. Oh, wow.
I don't know.
No?
I know who it is, but I didn't know he said that.
Want to play a song?
Isn't Biggie? That guy, he died, right? He was shot?
He died a long time ago.
He was shot, right?
Yeah.
He was assassinated.
Yeah.
Remember that? Wow. I won't go into that joke, but okay.
But also, did you hear that, speaking of, talking about different things that are going on, Megyn Kelly's leaving Fox. She's going to NBC. Surprise there.
Channel 4, very liberal station.
Good. That's go. Good.
NBC.
She voted for Hillary. I know she did.
Oh, please.
Oh, probably did.
We need – and I. There was one ad that I liked, the Wall Street Journal. They're running in order to, you know, increase subscription rates. And it talks about how they tried to give Donald Trump a fair shake during the election. And that's what the commercial is. And they have people talking about saying they knew that there was a possibility that Trump was going to win the election. And they talked about some of the articles they read in the paper. That is the best ad that I've saw. I wish we could you could post it on our website.
What? I have a suggestion, Eric and Frank and everyone out there listening. Chime in. Megan did the 9 o'clock slot. All right. So Tucker Carlson has 7. Megan O'Reilly had 8. Megyn Kelly had 9. Sean Hannity is 10.
I think Phil Jacino should have 9 o'clock.
This is what I propose. And it might be a bit of a commute for Frank and I.
And then Frank Vetro at 9:30.
Have Tucker Carlson do the 9 o'clock show. Well, no. See, I can't get to the city that quickly. So let me do the night with Frank and I can do Standing Up Principle at 9 o'clock. O'Reilly does the 8. Tucker keeps the 7. And then Sean Hannity comes in after. And then we can go on Sean Hannity and talk about Donald Trump.
We can beat a bridge.
So
we can build a bridge.
I'm waiting for, look, Frank, make sure you're looking at that phone because if Fox News calls, and wants to put us on the 9 o'clock hour, you got to be able to answer that phone, please.
Hey, guys, it's Roger Ailes on the line.
Roger, listen, we got to wrap things up. It's 9:30. It's 9:34. And according to Ed's contract, he can't go beyond 9:32.
That's fine.
We have to kind of wrap things up.
A lot of listeners in Atlanta. Yeah. Listen. Yeah, this is a great show tonight. Frank, you did a great job behind the board there.
Thanks, buddy.
Did. You earned your keep.
Exactly.
Listen, everybody.
I'm sure you make it. I'm you're getting paid a lot more than I am.
We're going to go out to some Ace Frehley.
You want to go to Ace Frehley or not the Hawaii 5-0?
It's Hawaii 5-0?
If you have it.
That's
in the contract.
I didn't have White Castles when I was in New York.
I love Hawaii 5-0.
Please, I'm trying not to eat late at night, so don't mention White Castle, please. I don't want to stop on the way home. Listen, everybody, thank you for watching.
I'm sorry. I got to head.
Is that the low-budget version?
I got it.
It's killing me down here. We're going to lose people.
I got it.
Thank you for listening. Thank you for watching. It was a great show. Join us next week, 8 o'clock, for Standing Our Principle every Tuesday, 9 o'clock, The Right Perspective with Phil Jacino and Eddie Vilbig.
Good night from Atlanta.
Everybody.